'Cause nothing else can take. It is good to be here and good to really begin to drill in and focus in on something that I think is God is doing in our church that's pretty amazing, and that is really focusing in on the Holy Spirit. And meant to have a picture up here of the poster for the Rain Down series, which is what we're going to be talking about in the next few weeks. And in that picture, if you haven't seen it on Facebook, you should take a look at it, and we'll have it up here next week. But the beauty of it is that it's this little girl whose hair is all wet, and you can tell her hair is all wet, and she's holding her hand out into the rain. I want us to be like that. Totally immersed, totally drenched in the Spirit of God, but putting our hand out for more. Holy Spirit, rain down. The seasons are changing. You probably noticed out, and you see the trees beginning to change color and turn color, and it's really awesome. It's one of my favorite times of the year is winter, and all of the plants are starting to get ready for winter. And we have a lot more dark in our day than light, and I love the fall. I really just love the winter, and it's not only because of duck hunting, but that's a piece of it, but that's not all of it, and that actually starts this weekend, and I'm excited about that, but I just really like the wintertime. In fact, you know, when the first rains start showing up in September, I just really enjoy that. Susan is a summertime person, and so she will actually go out in the summertime, and for the brief, like, 3 hours that we have sunshine in our yard in between the shade of all the trees, she will find a place and put her chair out there, and she'll just sit out there and let the sun hit her face. And for me, that would be like torture. When I walk in my yard and the sun's on it, I kind of find the shady spots and walk along that. But when September comes and those first rains, you know, those misty rains, and you can just walk outside and just put your face up, it just feels like your body is just absorbing all of the moisture that it lost all summer long. I love that. That might speak to a little bit about being born and raised in the Northwest, because Susan said that her kids at school will do that too. They'll go out and go, oh, this feels so good when the first rains come. I love that. That's what I want us to do. Put our face up. Holy Spirit, rain down. Isaiah 45:8 says this. This is God talking. You heavens above, rain down my righteousness. Let the clouds shower it down. Let the earth open wide. Let salvation spring up. Let righteousness flourish with it. I, the Lord, have created. Hosea 6:3 says this, let us acknowledge the Lord. Let us press on to acknowledge him. As surely as the sun rises, he will appear. He will come to us like the winter rains, like the spring rains that water the earth. And then Joel, second chapter, verse 28 and 29, and afterwards, I will pour out my spirit on all people. Your sons and your daughters will prophesy. Your old men will dream dreams, and your young men will see visions. Even on my servants, both men and women, I will pour out my spirit in those days. In that day, I'll pour out my spirit. In the second chapter of Acts, we see Peter who says that scripture is being fulfilled right here, right now. That scripture has been fulfilled. The Holy Spirit was poured out. And if you've been coming on Wednesday nights and you're in the adult program, you've been watching The Presence with Alec Rowland, as it talks about what it's like when the presence of God shows up, and it talks about how we should be desiring that and what the impacts of that are. And the question that I have for you is, do you want the Holy Spirit to rain down? Do you want the Holy Spirit to rain down? Do you want it to be poured out on us and in us? Do you want those refreshing rains to come down on you? You know, the early church, they were kind of, we think about them as being spirit-filled. We have the book of Acts up here. Evidently, Harbor Life is doing a book of Acts series. And praise the Lord, we're on the same page. When you think about the second chapter of Acts and you think about the early church, man, they were excited. And you think, wow, they must have really been expecting, knowing what it was that the Holy Spirit, they must have been experts on the Holy Spirit, right? But when it comes down to it, they really didn't know what to expect at all. They had no idea. Nothing like that had ever been experienced before. They saw a little limited foregleams of it. I mean, I love the story. I think it's in the book of Exodus where Moses is in the tent of meeting and God's Spirit is poured out on the elders. And one of the elders, he was late for the meeting and God poured his Spirit out on him anyway, and he still prophesied wherever he was as he made his way there. And Moses says, man, I wish you could all have this. What a beautiful thing that was. We see a little foregleam there. Or you have the times when the prophets of Israel, or they were with the prophets, and it said Saul went and prophesied with the prophets. You see the Holy Spirit being poured out on these limited number of people. And so we get little foregleams about that. But Jesus really didn't tell the apostles what to expect. He didn't say, here's how it's going to go down, and here's what you should expect. He didn't do that at all. Here's what he said in Luke 24. He said to them, this is what I told you while I was still with you. Everything must now be fulfilled that is written about me in the law of Moses and in the prophets and the Psalms. Then he opened their minds so that they could understand the scriptures, and he told them, this is what was written. The Messiah will suffer and rise from the dead, and on the third day, and in repentance and the forgiveness of sins will be preached in his name to all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things. I'm going to send you what my Father has promised. But stay in the city until you have been clothed with power from on high. That's what they were to do. They were to stay in the city until they had been clothed with power from on high. What did that mean? What did that mean? What do you think their expectations could have possibly been? I mean, they had just went through an incredible week, hadn't they? In fact, they'd been through a little bit longer than that because Jesus, as he's telling them to go into the city and wait, he had already been resurrected. And they'd just been through some amazing things. For instance, they had seen the one that they had been with for 3.5 years ministering and worshiping with him and realizing and coming to recognize him as the Son of God. And they'd just seen him crucified, killed, dead, buried for 3 days, and then resurrected. What do you think their expectations were? I mean, Joel's kind of cryptic. He's going to pour out my spirit upon my sons and my daughters, and everybody's going to prophesy, even the slaves, the servant girls. It doesn't matter. It's not according to who is who. It's going to be poured out on all flesh. But they really kind of didn't know what to expect. In some ways, I envy them. I envy them. They didn't have any preconceived notions of what it was going to look like or what would happen. They were not going to try and measure whether it happened or not by a particular sign that maybe showed up in somebody's life. They weren't going to look for that. Instead, they were just all up in the upper room waiting. Praying and waiting for the Spirit to be poured out. Waiting for it to rain down on them. For the next couple of weeks, we're going to talk about the Holy Spirit raining down on us and what we can kind of expect. It's a place to start. And the place to start is to desire that. Desire that the Holy Spirit would rain down on us. You see, I was raised in a really conservative Christian tradition. And because I was raised in a really conservative situation, we talked about the Holy Spirit, but then my dad kind of went to some different places, and we went to some camp meetings. And I don't know if some of you know the kind of camp meetings I'm talking about. And I went to some of these camp meetings, and there were, at these camp meetings, I saw stuff that, wow. Let's just put it this way. People were getting other people worked up, but it wasn't the Spirit of God. People were doing freaky, weird stuff, right? You don't know what I'm talking about, watching on TV, right? They were doing freaky, weird stuff. But it wasn't of God. And yet, even at those places, there were still godly people who were legitimately seeking God. So what did I do as a young Christian? I kind of sat in the back and I watched that and I thought, wow, that's not of God. Because some of the people that were doing the freakiest, weirdest stuff, I saw them afterwards and talked to them afterwards, and their life didn't match up with all this. You know, wow, I just had this great experience with God, and then they were doing this stuff, and I'm going, that doesn't work. And so I concluded it was all fake. I concluded it was all just nonsense. And so in our conversations about the Holy Spirit, the thing we were trying to do was, okay, we got to keep this Holy Spirit thing in a box because, you know, we don't want it getting out and looking like that. And I grew up most of my life with the Holy Spirit like this. I defined him in a nice doctrinal box, and I would just keep him right out there. In fact, I didn't call him, I called it. And I just kind of did that with the Holy Spirit. Just figured it was all counterfeit. Maybe that's been you too. Maybe you've thought about God, and as you think about God, the Holy Spirit, and the whole Trinity thing freaks you out because you don't know how to understand that. By the way, I just want to let you know, we don't understand it either, right? I mean, theologians that try and put it all in a box, listen, one of my wisest professors, he says, listen, we can't put the Trinity in a box. We can just put some boundaries on it, but the top's open because we don't fully understand it. We can't fully understand who God is. We can't put that amazingness in our brain. So maybe as you're trying to get your grip around this Holy Spirit thing and you're trying to figure out, well, how does this work and how is this in there? Maybe you're saying, wow, this is a little bit supernatural for me. And that challenges me a little bit. And I would kind of rather do this with the Holy Spirit because it's a little bit uncomfortable. Maybe that's you. I want to let you know that I lived my life a long time in that way. But I hope your journey and spiritual walk doesn't end there. I hope it continues to go past that and comes to the place where you can say to the Holy Spirit, rain down on me. Rain down on me. And I want to assure you as a pastor and as a church, we're not going to go to that place where people are doing freaky stuff, where people are barking like a dog or barking like a chicken and saying that's of God. That's not of God. We're not going there. We're not going there. We're not going to be the kind of church that uses music to try and get people all worked up. Because that's from yourself. I don't want myself. I already got myself. Amen? I can get myself worked up over Seahawks until the fourth quarter. But I want God's Spirit in me to overflow. Whatever He has for me, I want that. But I don't want any counterfeit stuff. And I don't want any stuff from man. I just want the stuff from God. And so I want us just to ask, to really ask a simple kind of question. Are we really seeking and asking for? Are we really desiring to be in the supernatural and unexplainable presence of God? Is that what we really desire in our hearts? Is that what we really want? Do we want that for ourselves? And this is what I want to tell you. We should. Amen? We should want that. We should absolutely want all that God has for us. We should absolutely want to be immersed in His Spirit. We want it to rain down on us and drench us like the oil that was poured over David running down his beard. That's what we should want. Raining down. And here's why. Because when the Holy Spirit is rained down on us, we won't be alone. It's just one reason, but it's a big one, right? We won't be alone. John 14 says this: If you love me, keep my commandments. And I will ask the Father, and He will give you another advocate to help you and be with you forever, the Spirit of truth. The world cannot accept Him because it has neither sees Him nor knows Him. But you know Him, for He lives with you and will be in you. I mean, the disciples were scared, right? They just spent this amazing time with Jesus Christ. They just spent this amazing time, and now He's telling them there in John, listen, I'm taking off, and I'm going to go back to the Father. And they're thinking, man, you're going to leave us alone. It was so great when they were with Jesus, right? It was so great because, listen, introducing Jesus when you're with Jesus, that's kind of pretty easy, right? Yeah, I wanted to introduce you to Jesus. There it was, you know. It's not, I got to tell you about Jesus and let me read in the Bible. It's just like, there He is. He's over there. And if you messed up, Jesus would know that, right? He could tell what you were thinking in your heart, and you could go back and you could tell Him, oh, I'm sorry, I messed that up. And maybe if you didn't understand, you could say, Jesus, I don't get this. Will you explain this parable to me? And He's saying, are you still so dull? Yeah, that's me, you know. Help me out, Jesus. And Jesus would help them. And they were so afraid because they were going to go, He was going to go and be with the Father, and He was going to leave them alone. And they were feeling like they were going to just be alone. And how scared that was going to be with all the things that were going on in their life. And you ever feel alone? You ever feel like, man, I'm the only person that can really understand how I'm feeling because I'm the only person who's really gone through what I'm going through. And you feel alone. Now, it's not a rational feeling, right? Because we understand that, you know, other people have been through stuff that's worse than us. You know, if you're feeling bad, turn on the news. You'll feel like, oh, they got it worse than me. And we kind of get that kind of a thing, but that doesn't change the feeling. And when we really feel alone, isn't it amazing the first thing that God does in creation? He creates a companion for Adam. Why? Because it was not good that humanity should be alone. It was not good that Adam should be by himself. He needs a companion. We need somebody to be around us. We hate being alone. You know, even hermits hate to be alone. Think about this, right? Remember the Unabomber? Wasn't he great? I mean, I don't know if some of you are going, who's that? But some of you are old enough to remember that. There was this loony guy who was sending stuff to college professors, and they were bombs. And they would open this package, and it would blow up and kill them. And nobody knew where it was coming from. Well, it turns out that it was this crazy guy living in a shack all by himself in Montana. Who knew? That's why it took like 10 years to catch him. All by himself. And you're thinking, oh yeah, here's a hermit. He just wants to be all by himself. What does he do? He writes a manifesto so everybody can read it. Even the crazy people that think they want to be alone don't really want to be alone. We hate being alone as humans. It's one of the worst things we could ever experience. The disciples wanted reassurance that they would not be left all alone. Jesus said this amazing thing. He said, I will send another advocate, another helper. That word another is kind of unique because there's a couple ways another can be. Another could be something different, or another could be another one just like me. And the Holy Spirit was going to be another just like Jesus. He's telling them, listen, I'm leaving, but the Father is going to send the Holy Spirit who's going to be just like me, and he's going to be with you forever so that you will never, ever be alone. Never, ever be alone. He will be with you in the hardest moments of your life. You're not going to be alone. He will be with you when you are facing the death of a loved one. He'll be there. He's going to be with you when you're facing some persecution at work or in your community. He's going to be with you when your relationships are not working right. He's going to be there. He's going to be with you when you're afraid of what is coming. Maybe you can see it coming. Man, this is going to hurt. And he's going to be with you in that moment. Romans 5:5 says, and hope does not disappoint us because God's love is poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit that has been given to us. God's love is poured into our hearts. You see, the thing about being not alone is that we feel love from another person. It's what we really want. And when the Holy Spirit is being poured into our hearts, we experience the love of God in such an amazing way. It's a universal quality of the Holy Spirit being poured out into someone's life. It's this experience of God's love. And when the Holy Spirit of God is not with you, then you're forced to rely on yourself. Right? You're forced to rely on yourself, and you know, and I know, that you're unreliable. Amen? Right? Because I know that about myself, and if anybody knows how unreliable it is, that would be you. You know how unreliable you are, just like I know how unreliable I am. You know your limits. You know that you can be pushed too far, can't you? And you know what that looks like. You know what the last straw on the camel's back would be. You know that. And because of that, you're afraid. You don't want to experience that. We do all kinds of things because we're afraid of experiencing that. We do things where we don't take risks. We do things where we hold still. We're not going to go over there because I know what my limit is, and I think that would be pushing my limit too far. We're afraid. The scripture says this, I can do all things through him who gives me strength. I can do anything through him who gives me strength. All of a sudden, the fear comes away. You see, we want the Holy Spirit to rain down in our life because we will not be afraid anymore. Why? Because we're not alone. You don't walk in the inner city by yourself. That's just silliness, right? Unless you're the biggest, meanest guy. And the thing is, there's always somebody that's bigger and meaner. Or else there's somebody that's smaller that's got a gun. Yeah. But if you're with someone else, then you're not so afraid. And the Holy Spirit says, I will never leave you nor forsake you. The Holy Spirit's being poured out. I want to look with my face up into the rain and say, Holy Spirit, pour down, rain down on me because I don't want to be alone in anything. I want you right there by my side. I want you right there so that I have courage, right there so that I have strength. So that whatever I face in this life, I will never, ever be alone. Do you want that? We also want the Holy Spirit for another reason. We want him to rain down on us because the Holy Spirit convicts us of sin. Wow, that doesn't sound very happy, but let's read about it. John 16 says this, "Nevertheless, I tell you the truth, it's to your advantage, says Jesus, that I will go away. For if I do not go away, the advocate will not come to you. But if I go, I will send him to you. And when he comes, he will prove the world wrong about sin and righteousness and judgment. About sin, because they do not believe in me. About righteousness, because I'm going to the Father and you will see me no longer. And about judgment, because the ruler of this world has been condemned." So back to verse 8, he says, when he comes, he will prove the world wrong about sin and righteousness and judgment. See, another way of saying that is that he will convict the world about sin. He will convict the world of sin. Wow, I mean, there is some really good news in that verse. Some really good news for us. And the first is this, is that the Holy Spirit will convict the world of sin. Don't you love it when somebody says, listen, I know you were doing this over there, but that's my job. You know when I like that the most? Is when I am washing dishes. You know, somebody comes up and says, listen, no, get out of the way. This is my job. I got this. You go do this over there. Oh, thank you. Yes. I love that. The Holy Spirit was sent to convict the world of sin. Guess what? It's not your job. Get out of the kitchen. We are not the ones that have to go out into the world and convict the world of sin. Praise the Lord. That is a crummy job, isn't it? That means that we as Christians, we don't have to go out and say, listen, you're living your life wrong, and I'm here to point it out to you. We don't have to hold up signs at funerals that say, you're living your life wrong, because that's the Holy Spirit's job, is to convict the world of sin. We don't have to do it. In fact, the Trinity is full. There's no job opening. There's no desire. Nowhere in the place does it, in the Bible does it say, listen, Christians, I want you to go out and convict the world of sin. He will convict the world of sin. It is not our job. And when we do it poorly. Why? Because we're trying to replace the Holy Spirit. Doesn't that just sound stupid of us, right? What are you doing? Oh, I'm just trying to do the Holy Spirit's job. Wow. We never say that out loud, do we? Because we just feel dumb. Rightly so. It is not our job. And man, that is such good news. That is such freedom for us, isn't it? Because we can go into a world where there's sin that is everywhere and you can't avoid it. It's everywhere, in everything, on everything. The taint of sin is, it's like grease. But we don't have to deal with it, because that's not our deal. That's the Holy Spirit's job. He will convict the world of sin. And the world is convicted. You'll hear people say, oh, yeah, I've made my peace with God. But then they're still afraid to die. Why? Because they didn't make any peace with God. You'll hear people say, oh, yeah, well, I don't care about God. I'm just going to live my life the way I'm going to live my life. And then they say things like this. Well, I'm just going to go to hell because that's where all my friends are going to be. Wait a minute. Oh, yeah. See, they already feel the conviction of the Holy Spirit. They already know, guess what? This is what my life is going to end up like. And they're okay with it. But they feel that conviction. We don't have to convict them. They already feel it. They already know they've fallen short. And even those people that assert that the way they're living is some kind of fundamental right or something like that, you know what? Deep down inside, when they're all by themselves, the Holy Spirit has talked to them, and they know that it's wrong. Which probably explains why they're trying so hard to convince everybody else that it's right. The Holy Spirit has been poured out on all flesh. He has convicted the world of sin. And they don't believe Jesus. But he's doing his job. We don't have to do it. And I praise God for that. Here's the second thing that is just so such great news for us. And that is that he's going to convict us of sin too. He's going to convict us of sin. Galatians 5:16 says, so I say this, walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. For the flesh desires what is contrary to the Spirit, and the spirit what is contrary to the flesh. They're in conflict with each other so that you do not do whatever you want. But if you're led by the Spirit, you're not under the law. See, if you're led by the Spirit, then the law doesn't have any impact on you. If the speed limit is 150, I don't know, maybe on the Autobahn in Germany, and your car only goes 70, then the speed limit has no bearing on you, right? The Holy Spirit, if we're being led by the Holy Spirit, then we are not going to enter into and grab onto sin. But here's the great thing about the Holy Spirit. He will convict us of our sin if we make a mistake. He will convict us. When disciples were with Jesus, they could just ask him, did I do that wrong? And he would tell them. But now that Jesus is gone, the Holy Spirit has come, and he will convict us of our sins. And that is just really good news. You see, it's really nice to have the Holy Spirit come in and tell me when I'm doing something wrong, because I might not see it. I might think I'm justified in my own mind. I might think, well, yeah, this is, I can do this. And the Holy Spirit will come in and say, no, you ought not to do that. You ever be selfish? You ever done something selfish? I know you have. And don't we want to disagree with the Holy Spirit? Well, this isn't selfish because, you know, I'm kind of treating myself here, and it's okay. And we do all this rationalization stuff, and because why? Well, we're having a conversation with the Holy Spirit who's convicting us of our sin of selfishness, but we're trying to convince him that it's okay. And we still feel guilty, and it's only when we're being led by the Spirit we just stop that selfishness and we submit to him and do it. Do whatever it is he's asking us to do. And see, isn't it amazing? The Holy Spirit convicts us and moves us back into the right place where we can live our lives. I'm so thankful for that, because you know what? I don't have to live in such a way that I'm always worried about the end of my life. Man, I sure hope I worship God enough. Man, I sure hope I got all the sin in my life out. You know, is that going to be your last thought before you know, you're dying? Maybe you're in the bed, you're looking up at the little blinking lights. Or I don't know how you're going to die, right? Who knows? Maybe it's going to be an ostrich. I was talking about somebody the other day that in the kingdom of God, I don't know if we're going to remember how we died or not. But there are some people that hope they don't, right? Like, you always hear about, oh yeah, an ostrich, man, they could just kick you and kill you. Can you imagine the guy that got kicked and killed by an ostrich? How embarrassing is that? You're in heaven, you're talking, how'd you die? Ostrich. Oh, really? Yeah. Or it's all fun and games till somebody gets their eye poked out, right? How did you die? Well, you know that thing about the eye poking out? You know, that's embarrassing. I don't know how it is you're gonna die, and I don't know how I'm gonna die, but I'm hoping that wherever it is, that my last thought is not, wow, I hope I did enough stuff for God. Because what a scary way to live. Man, I hope I did enough stuff. Or I hope I got all the stuff out of my life so that I'm pure and holy before God. I want to live my life right now in total freedom, knowing that if God called me home right now, if I blew an aorta and fell down right there, praise the Lord, I feel good. Amen? And you see, the Holy Spirit convicting us of our sin doesn't allow the sin to stay there. So what do we do when we're in our prayer life? We say, God, forgive me for my sins. And all of a sudden he does, and we're pure, and we can walk before him all the time. We don't have to live in fear. And the Holy Spirit is convicting us of our sins. Praise God. I want to stand with my face up and say, rain down, Holy Spirit. Convict me of my sins so that my relationship with God is pure and holy all the time. And then I don't have to live afraid. I can walk with confidence and strength, and how amazing it is when that's the case. Do you want the Holy Spirit to rain down on you and rain down in your life? Now, there's a million reasons why I want the Holy Spirit to rain down on me, but I'm going to just go to this last one. And we find this one in John chapter 7. On the last and greatest day of the festival, Jesus stood, and in a loud voice he said, let anyone who is thirsty come to me and drink. Whoever believes in me, as Scripture has said, rivers of living water will flow from within them. And by this, as John, he meant the Spirit, whom those who believed him were later received. Up until that time, the Spirit had not been given since Jesus had not yet been glorified. Rivers of life flowing out of us. Rivers of life. How's your river? How's your river? You know, when the rain comes here in the winter, sometimes it's got to go somewhere. We know that probably more than other people, right? Because we live here in this place where we get 40 inches of rain in a year. And if you try to ever build something, one of the things the building department wants to know is, where's the water that hits your property going to go? Because they don't really want it to go into your neighbor's yard, although it seems like your neighbor's water always comes to yours, right? But that's the thing they want to know, where's that water going to go? Because that water's going to go somewhere. And every once in a while, and it's an El Nino year, you probably learned about that, and El Nino, and that means in Spanish, the Nino, okay? And what is that? Well, that is going to be this extra dry season. This extra dry season where we're not going to get as much rain, but every once in a while during El Nino years, we get the Pineapple Express, which is really a lot of fun, isn't it? Because we get like 7 days of torrential rain. It just keeps coming, just keeps coming, just keeps coming. And pretty soon, all the ground, and our ground really can saturate, it can handle a lot of water, but all of a sudden, the ground is completely saturated, and the water just starts sitting on top of the ground. And if you're a duck hunter, about that time, you get really happy. But for the rest of the world, it's kind of unhappy because this water has to go somewhere. That's what it is with the Spirit of God. We want a Pineapple Express, amen? Because what happens is the Spirit of God fills us up, and it fills in every pore, and it fills in every weakness, and we're not alone, and suddenly we feel strong because our life is pure before him. And then what happens then? Well, the Spirit of God begins to flow out from us. And it flows out into other people. And it flows out at our job. And it flows out as we go to the grocery store. It flows out as we go to different places. And people notice it. Susan and I went to swim the other day, a couple of weekends ago, just as a weekend away. We left after church and we got to the place, and swim's about 45 minutes or so from here, and we got to the little place that we had rented, and I had dutifully online done that, and we get there, and she said she was going to leave a note for us in the window so that we could check in because I had church. I knew I was going to get there late, and we get there, there's no note on the window. Well, okay, that's kind of interesting. But there was a phone number, so I called it, and in the midst of calling it, I said, well, we've made a reservation. And she says, no, you didn't. Well, I think I did. No, you did. Probably the other place got the reservation. Oh, really? Okay, well, let me, can you just stay on the line? And then our phone kept dropping. It kept dropping off. Why? Because Squim's so close to Canada, the Canadian towers were trying to get my phone, which they did, and got like $5 in roaming fees from me, which was annoying. But more than that, we were talking on the phone, and she kept dropping off, and I just worked with her, and eventually she said, oh, I am so sorry. You're right. You do have the reservation here. Just go over there. The room should be unlocked. I went over. It was locked. I called her back. The room's locked. She says, okay, go to the other one. So we went to the other one, and we were able to get in. And later, as we were checking out, we had a wonderful weekend away. We went up to Hurricane Ridge, and it was so wonderful. We just enjoyed ourselves a lot, and we were going away, and we checked out with her. And as we checked out, she said, listen, I just want to say that there was something, I don't know what it is, but you were just so calm and so nice to me, even though I was messing up. She just said, thank you. You see, when the Holy Spirit is raining down on us, all of a sudden it will flow into other people, and other people will notice, wow, where was that? Where did that come from? I mean, I had every right to be mean and nasty and give her bad reviews and say very ugly things about her. But that's not what the Spirit of God would call you to do, is it? When you're walking a step with the Spirit, you just give people grace. We had to sleep in our car. Well, praise the Lord, it was an adventure. Right? It just flows out. Where's it going to flow out in your life? Do you want that in your life? You see, if you are so thirsty for the Spirit of God, that you're not being filled up, it's not going to flow into anybody else's life. You're going to become self-centered. You're going to be all about you. But if you've got your head up, your face up to the sky, and the rain is coming down, and you are just filled up, that Holy Spirit's got to go somewhere. And it's going to go out at work, and it's going to go out wherever you are in the community, and it's going to go out in your worship. It's going to go out in your church. And people will, it will be impact people. Because that's what the Holy Spirit does. That's why I want it to rain down on me. So that I will have rivers of life flowing out of me. Rivers of life flowing out. Do you want that? Today, I just want you to ask a question of yourself. Are you ready to ask and plead that the Holy Spirit would rain down on you? We're not asking somehow that we become elevated and special and that some kind of weird, freaky stuff happens to us. We're not asking about that. That's not why we want the Holy Spirit. Because that becomes all about us and our own experience. What we're asking is the Holy Spirit would rain on us so that we would know we're not alone. And that was the heart of Jesus as he said, I'm going to pour out my Spirit. Why? Because then I will never leave you and forsake you. And you'll know. You're not alone. We're asking the Holy Spirit rain down on us so that we will be convicted, so that we can walk through this life with complete and total confidence. Not so we'd feel guilty and bad, but so that we would get rid of it and restore a relationship with God. So that in any given moment, we know we're not ignoring the Holy Spirit. We're walking in step with the Holy Spirit, which means the law doesn't even have any impact on us. Why? Because we're not going over the speed limit. And so our whole life can be lived in worship and confidence. And we're praying, Holy Spirit, rain down on me, not just for me, but because I want to experience the promise that Jesus said that there would be rivers of life flowing out of me. Lord, bring the pineapple express because that water needs to go all over. I've walked around in this greasy, sinful world, and man, they need the cleansing water of life. Pour down on me. Holy Spirit, rain down. The next few weeks as we talk about the Holy Spirit raining down, as we talk about the impacts that it has on us, as we talk about the impacts that it has on our church, join me in that prayer. When you hear that rain down phrase, and you're going to hear it in a song that we're going to sing as a closing song, and you're going to hear it in other places, as you hear it, make that a prayer for you. Make that a prayer for you. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, I just thank you and I praise you for the incredible, miraculous gift that you give us, the gift of intimacy with you as your Holy Spirit has been poured into our life. It's incredible. It's amazing. There are not words to describe how it is that you do this. And I pray, Lord, that the desire of our heart and the cry of our heart would be that you would rain down on us. Rain down on us. Let our face be just lifted up to you, absorbing all of that wonderful rain that you pour out. Lord, so that your Spirit fills us so much that we would never, ever feel alone. So that your Spirit fills us so much that we couldn't have sin in our life because it would just bother us so much. So we get it out so that we're pure and holy and can walk with confidence. Holy Spirit, rain down on us so that we become that river of life. And Lord, that we as a church would truly be a wellspring, that source of life in our community. And I pray, Lord, not only for today, but I pray in the weeks coming, as we consider this, as we think about this, that Lord, we would pray, Holy Spirit, rain down on me. It's what we desire. Thank you, Lord, for what you're already doing in our lives. And thank you for what you're about to do. I praise you in Jesus' name. Amen.
believe.